Sea level rise is reshaping our planet, literally. As our oceans accelerate upwards, they wreak havoc on our coastlines, threatening many millions across the globe. Now, some scientists fear that ice sheets could collapse much faster than what used to be our worst-case scenarios.
It's not a question of if they will rise, it's a question of how much and when.
So why might the world's ice be so unstable? What can we do to protect ourselves? And could we potentially even hold back the world's immense ice?
It's without doubt the hardest civil engineering job that humanity will have ever done.
So could this actually work? Sea level rise can be caused by mountain glaciers melting and the expansion of ocean water as it heats up. But this is what we should be most afraid of: ice sheets. These vast bodies of ice, located in Antarctica and Greenland, contain 99% of all the freshwater ice on Earth. And since this ice sits on land, when it flows into the ocean, it raises sea levels. And if the ice sheets melted entirely, that would raise our oceans by over 60 meters.
Worldwide, half of our population lives near coasts, so this is a really significant thing.
This is Ella Gilbert, a polar climate scientist who has studied the ice on both sides of the planet. So far, ice sheets have only contributed modestly to sea level rise, but that could change very quickly. The ice sheets are on land, but the problem happens when the ice sheet ends underwater. The shape of the seabed that the ice sits on is crucial. If the ice rests on top of a hill like this, that can help hold it in place. But if warming seas cause the ice to retreat to a point where the bedrock slopes back, that can be a big problem. As this point moves further and further back, the ice at this point becomes taller, and taller ice is like a wider open tap. Its bigger surface means that more can flow through it. This means more ice is lost to the ocean, which means the ice is now even taller, and so lost even faster, in a vicious cycle. This process has the catchy name marine ice sheet instability. And scientists are already worried that this point of no return, known as a tipping point, may have been reached for certain key glaciers in West Antarctica. But another threat could turbocharge collapse of the ice sheets: marine ice cliff instability. This warns that cliffs at the edge of ice sheets could become so high that they can't support their own weight and collapse. But since the ice sheet further back would be even higher, it would be even more unstable, and so the collapse would continue. Because marine ice sheet and ice cliff instability would add ice to the oceans, they would be major driving forces raising our seas.
So if we have these two fairly scary processes combining and causing accelerated ice loss, then that could lead to really dramatically higher sea level rise contributions.
And these scary processes could lead to this. This is from the latest IPCC report summarizing the state of our knowledge of climate change. This key curve from the report stopped me in my tracks when I first saw it. It shows that the more we emit, the higher seas could rise. Nothing new there. But it also shows this: potential sea level rise of almost 2 meters this century alone. If these tipping points do indeed take place, a truly devastating level of sea level rise taking place within the lifetimes of children born today. The truth is, we still don't know just how big a role ice sheet or ice cliff instability could play in the future. The IPCC describes this curve as a low likelihood, high impact possibility. That's IPCC talk for it's not likely to happen, but we can't rule it out, and it would be devastating if it did. And let's be clear. The different drivers of sea level rise would keep raising our oceans for centuries, even once we stop the world heating up.
If you go into, say, 3 centuries later on, say 2300, the rise could actually reach up to 6 meters. We have to brace ourselves for a huge rise in sea level.
This is Pranab Deb, who researches extreme events taking place in Antarctica. The seas would keep rising because it takes the world's dense oceans and ice a long time to absorb the heat and react to the hotter atmosphere. Just like a swimming pool takes a long time to heat up during the day, but stays warm long into the night. And the consequences of even 1 meter of sea level rise by the end of the century would be massive. Coastal erosion could eliminate small island states and devastate low-lying countries like Bangladesh or cities like Miami. And these problems are multiplied when the seas rise during storms, known as storm surges. On top of all this, rising seas could actually reduce our access to fresh water, as rising salt water contaminates groundwater supplies.
We could be looking at around 124 to 130 million people living in areas that could be exposed to flooding.
This is Sally Brown, a climate scientist investigating the impacts of sea level rise and what we can do to adapt.
We're looking at costs around $23 to $31 trillion per year. So huge numbers of costs that are going to be coming on an annual basis.
Those millions of people would be from all over the world. Think cities like Bangkok, New York and Lagos, and countries like Japan, the Netherlands and the Maldives. Cutting emissions would go some way to protecting us, but even in the best case scenario, we'll still have to deal with additional sea level rise, and emissions aren't currently following the best case scenario. But there are measures we can take to protect ourselves from rising seas. For one, you could protect the areas where threatened people live by building defences like seawalls, widening beaches, or enhancing natural protections like mangroves. And, where possible, people have already started moving their homes and businesses further inland. But given the scale of the problem, building defences and relocating people can only achieve so much.
It's also that realisation that you can't do that everywhere. So there is sort of a scary point of, if we can't do things, what happens next?
Well, what if, instead of protecting the world's coasts from rising seas, we could find a way to fix the problem at the source? Given just how radical the problem is, some scientists have suggested a radical solution, the hope that we could hold the world's ice sheets back, stopping them from raising the seas. This is an example of targeted geoengineering. Normal geoengineering, for example using cooling aerosols to undo global warming, could have devastating far-reaching side effects, like disrupting monsoon rains. The hope is that tackling ice loss at the source could be both easier to achieve while only having local side effects. Ice sheets are flowing into the ocean through certain channels. The colours here show the speed of key glaciers in West Antarctica. And so it would be a matter of finding a way to plug these outlets. But these channels can still be kilometres wide. And how do you plug something so massive? One idea would involve sucking up water from the base of ice sheets. Since the water lubricates the boundary between ice and land, removing it creates more friction and would make it harder for the ice to slide into the ocean. Another would see an artificial island or ridge built to pin the ice sheet in place, helping to hold it back. But these ideas could use huge amounts of energy and materials to implement. Now, the group of researchers are proposing what they hope would be a more practical approach.
The idea is actually to use a seabed anchored curtain.
This is John Moore, a polar and geoengineering scientist. John hopes that a curtain anchored to the seabed and floating vertically would hold back warmer waters from reaching the ice. This would protect the ice sheet, turning back the clock on melting. And John is hopeful that, as fanciful as it sounds, it could be achieved with today's technology.
If we had to build this structure in a temperate ocean without ice, we could start doing it tomorrow. The kinds of materials are ready available. There is no unobtainium.
Still, John says this curtain would have to be 80 kilometres long and cost $50 billion, enough for 10 Large Hadron Colliders. That's the world's largest particle accelerator. Yes, that's pretty huge, but considering the trillions of dollars of damages that sea level rise could cause, or the thousands of kilometers of coastlines that could need protecting, the team behind this idea are hopeful that it could actually present something of a bargain.
There are enormous gains and benefits to be had, but it's not going to be trivial.
Not trivial is a pretty massive understatement for such an enormous engineering endeavour, as simple as it may look here. Although John and collaborators have discussed their ideas in top scientific journals and conferences, other researchers have poured a fair amount of cold water on their proposals.
Creative, out-of-the-box ideas. I mean, of course, we need to look into those alternatives, but one thing that we have to be sure about is the practicality of those ideas.
Pranab is concerned that setting up projects like these in the Antarctic, in the middle of turbulent seas and floating sea ice, would be incredibly difficult.
That's one of the harshest environments in the world, right? And when you try to build a structure like that, there are strong undercurrents in the area. It's easy to get an idea and really, you know, get excited about it, but we have to be extra cautious.
And even if one of these projects were to be built, there would be dangers. We might not fully appreciate how they'd affect the ice they aim to protect, or how warm waters that have been diverted affect neighbouring glaciers.
It's also very risky, because if suddenly if that fails, sea levels could rise very fast.
Some scientists are worried that such ideas distract from the hard work that we know we need to do.
I feel like geoengineering is very much a sticking plaster for a symptom, rather than addressing the real issue, which is burning fossil fuels.
There are a huge number of question marks over whether we will follow this curve or this one, and whether any local geoengineering could help bend the curve. But it's clear that the more fossil fuels we burn and the hotter the planet gets, the more unstable the world's ice sheets will become. That's because even though the seas would keep rising after we stop burning fossil fuels, how much they rise in total depends on how much we burn in total. And stopping burning fossil fuels wouldn't just help protect the ice sheets, it would also limit other sources of sea level rise.
We absolutely need to take very serious measures to prevent what might be the end of our civilization.
And however we choose to cut our emissions, adapt our coastlines across the globe, or even attempt to hold back our ice sheets, it's clear that there's no time to wait.
What we do now really determines the future that we see by the end of the century.
So, do you think we could actually build a huge underwater curtain to hold the ice back? And if we could, do you think we should? Subscribe to Planet A. We have new videos out every Friday with other complicated props.